Lowrider magazine blew me away. It was 1978, and I seen the cars. I seen a car hopping, and I was like, oh, goodness, this is what I want to do. This is going to be my world now. I own a 1962 Chevy Impala Super Sport. It's Roman red, chrome undercarriage, complete front and back, 350 motor, 350 transmission. I've done a lot of upgrades, and one special thing about lowriding, you get to think out of the box when you start building these cars. So I did change the skirts on it a little bit. I got both spotlights left and right. I got remote mirrors both sides. I got the color bar inside. Yeah, I got a lot of the bells and whistles. I got 13-inch rims with Remington tires, radio, so it runs smooth. So I got two pumps, two high-low pumps, high power pumps that I can hop three-wheel, you know, side to side. I got four dumps on it. I got stainless steel tubing on it, all chrome, and customized trunk. I did name my car the Crystal Ship. It's a song from The Doors. The reason I called it that is because when I'm driving it, it just feels like it's like a spaceship or something. So that's the car I own. I purchased the car about 20 years ago, and I didn't think I was gonna keep it for so long. I figured I'll fix it up and then maybe sell it or get another one. But I decided to continue working on it, and the more I worked on it, the more I fell in love with it. And it's just, I feel I'm gonna keep this car until, you know, I pass. And I haven't decided what instructions I have for my wife and kids to do with it after I pass. But for now, I'm gonna cruise the heck out of it and enjoy with the family all over the place. My mom and dad are both from Mexico. My dad was, he was born in Michoacán, and my mom was born in Guadalajara in Jalisco. So he dated her and they got married. They had three kids. They moved to the United States. I was 7 years old when we came over here. So as we're growing up in San Diego, you know, more and more Mexican people were buying homes in that area. You know, so you kind of didn't lose that heritage. You didn't lose that custom or that tradition from living in Tijuana during the Christmas, during, you know, whichever celebration was going on, Dia de los Muertos and stuff. So it was great growing up in that neighborhood and having a lot of friends and family that were Mexicanos, were Chicanos and stuff. And of course, it's real cool because we have the border. From my house, we have it 10 minutes away. So whenever we wanted real Mexican food, my dad said, let's go to Tijuana. My mom had a lot of family in the San Jose area in a little town called Alviso. And that's where I picked up the bug of the lowrider. It got into my blood. It was back in 1974. My cousin Johnny and my cousin Pepe rolled up on some lowrider bikes. And I looked at the bikes and I'm like, what is that? It's like, oh my goodness, that's something beautiful. It's just, you know, like seeing Mickey Mouse for the first time in your life, you know, it just blew me away. My dad owned a lot of cars and he worked on the cars. And on Saturdays, Sundays, or anytime he had work on the cars, he would tell me, come on, let's go work on the car. Dad, I want to go play. Nope, you're going to help me. I want you to learn. So I picked that up in high school, working on cars. And then I noticed that a lot of my friends weren't really into mechanics, but I was the one helping them out. I was the one changing the belts, alternators, stereos, suspension parts in high school. And even the teacher told me, you know what? You have a gift in your hands that you should follow it. So after high school, one day, one of my friends told me, hey, they need a mechanic helper at one of the dealerships here in National City. You should check it out. So I went down there, talked to the manager, and he goes, I need you to start tomorrow. And I'm like, well, that sounds good. So I started as a mechanic helper, and I worked there actually for 24 years. It was a Buick dealership. While I was working at Jack Harrison Buick, I got approached by one of my friends, and he told me, hey, the city's hiring mechanics. Why don't you apply for the city? So I applied, and it took me 5 years to get in. I got a call one day from one of the directors there, and he said, hey, you know, my name is so-and-so, and we're calling from the city. I want to offer you a job. I'm like, okay, what's the job offer? You know, well, it's for the fire department, working on fire trucks and fire engines. Well, you know, it would be an honor for me to work for the fire department. I'll accept the job. And so I remember the first day, one of the guys asked me, so what do you know about fire engines? And I'm like, you know, I know nothing about them, but I know they're red. But I didn't know how to swim, and I learned. I didn't know how to speak English, but I learned. And I'm gonna learn how to work on these fire engines. And I have a gift, it's in my hand. And he goes, well, good luck, you know, because it's a big responsibility. And you're working for a company that it's an emergency apparatus, so we gotta be on top of things. You know, we can't second guess or think we're gonna repair it. You gotta make sure it's done correct. So that really stuck to me, like, okay, I want this challenge. I really want this challenge. So I've been there for now 13 years working for the City of San Diego Fire Department. I feel blessed because, you know, being a lowrider guy, you know, with tattoos and everything, you know, sometimes they look at you, ah, he's a homie from the hood. He owns a lowrider. Can he do the job? And I'm really well respected from all the guys, all the crew, because they've learned that when they get to the shop, where's Marcos at? You know, we want him to work on our apparatus. And I get my tools and I go right at it and repair them and stuff. And it feels real good to work on these trucks because you know that they are something that will save somebody's life, somebody's home, maybe a cat up in the tree, but you know, it feels really good. And believe it or not, there's been times that I'm picking up my tools and on the radio I hear fire engine so-and-so, the one I just worked on, within seconds or a minute, a man, a 45 or 50 year old man, cardiac arrest. And I'm like, wow. And I see the fire crew come out, jump in their rigs and just turn on the lights and fly down the street. It gives me this satisfaction, like, wow, I'm gonna save the life. You know, sorry, I'm getting a little. It hits you in the heart, you know. It feels good. I feel honored. Being the president of Impala Scar Club, the San Diego chapter, throughout the years, you know, I've learned, like, wow, you know, if you show a little love and a little respect and put it all together in the same bowl, you know, you're gonna be very well respected. And make sure you talk to people, shake their hands. You know, I go to a lot of car shows and a lot of lowrider events, and I'm always talking to people. I've always told my club members, if anybody ever comes and asks you a question about your car, don't shine them off. Don't tell them, hey, nice car, thank you. What year is it? You know, 62. You know, give them that 1 minute, 2 minutes to talk to them. Oh, it's a 1962 Chevy Impala. You know, I've had it for so many years. And then believe it or not, they'll open up and say, oh, my father had one, my uncle had one, I had one. And it shows the love that we have for our cars. Well, last year, I was going about 100 miles an hour in life. I was working overtime Saturdays, Sundays, 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, you know, working with my club on Fridays, going to car shows. And one Saturday morning, June 1st, I was at work and I started walking towards the lunchroom and I noticed I was limping. And it felt like a Charlie horse. There was something wrong with my leg and I didn't think much of it. I sat down, talked to my friends, my coworkers, we were laughing. When I got up, I noticed I was getting worse. So I went inside the office and I told my boss, hey, I don't feel good. I'm gonna go home. He said, all right, you okay? I go, yeah, I'm fine. So I got home and my wife says, no, you're going to urgent care. So she took me to urgent care. I limped all the way inside. They took me in right away. The doctor looked at me, he goes, there's something wrong with you. I don't want to be responsible, but I think you're having a stroke. So they called the fire department, and my friends got there like, hey, what are you doing here? It's like, yeah, I don't feel good. All right, rush him to the hospital. Hours went by, I fell asleep, and I woke up around 1 or 2 in the morning at the hospital, and I couldn't feel my right side. I couldn't move my hand. I couldn't move my leg. I was slurring a little bit on my right side, and I'm like, where's my hand at? You know, my hand's there, my leg is there. I can move my left arm, fingers and everything, and leg and everything. So it was 4 in the morning, and my brain went wild. You know, my brain started thinking, of my kids, my father, my wife, my family. What's next? My job. You know, it's like, oh man, am I gonna be able to drive again? Am I gonna be able to walk again? What's gonna happen to me? You know, I was there for 3 days, and the doctor told me that what's gonna happen. He says, you know, your brain's gonna have to teach itself how to walk again, how to move your hands, your fingers. It's gonna be a rough road, but there's only one way you're gonna get through it if you stay positive. If you become a person that's gonna be negative or is not gonna have the will to wanna continue, you're gonna stay like that. You won't be able to walk. I'm a very positive guy. I enjoy life, and I always stay positive. Even when there's something going on, I try to stay positive. So I made up my mind. I said, you know what? I'm gonna get through this. Somehow, some way, I'm gonna get through it. My wife said, don't worry, babe. We're gonna get through this. We'll take it one day at a time. She's been my doctor. She's been my nurse, my support, just everything for me. And I truly, from the heart, appreciate that very much. Once I got home, I remember sometimes I would be sitting there and I would hear this noise, and you know, two or three fire trucks would pull up. Some of the crew, hey, how are you? How you doing, man? You know, stay positive, stay positive. We want you back in the shop. Or you want us to bring the rigs here, you can work on them here. You know, joking around and stuff. So within, I believe, with a month and a half, I started to use a wheelchair. And once in a while, once or twice a week, I would go to the garage, open the garage door, look at my car and says, I haven't forgot you, I'll be back. You and I are gonna go somewhere one of these days. I'm gonna drive you again. Don't worry, I'm gonna drive you. So after I was able to walk, one day I walked into the garage. I told my wife, check this out. I went with my cane, I opened the garage door. I go, check this out, babe. I went out there, grabbed my key. She goes, what are you gonna do? I'm gonna turn my car on. I think the battery is still good. I turned it on. And I opened the garage door, the main door. Car was still dusty, car was still dirty. I put it in reverse. She goes, are you sure? I go, yes. I put it in reverse, I rolled down the driveway, and I said, I'm back, baby. So with time, I started driving more and more. I didn't want to go out just yet to any picnic, to any event. I didn't want to get bombarded by all the love and friends. Hey, how you doing? Oh my goodness. Because everybody wanted to know what happened. And my wife, we joke around, baby steps, oh yes, baby steps and stuff. And one time I just said, you know what? I'm ready. Send a text out. We're gonna be at J Street, you know, at a picnic, whoever wants to come out here. So my club responded. We're all going out there. I parked and got off the car with my cane. And you know, I noticed nobody approached me. Everybody kind of stood back. So that felt real good. They gave me my space for a while. And after an hour of being there and stuff, I told my members, you know, I'm a little tired. I think it's time for me to go home and stuff. And I jumped back in my car, and as I was leaving out, I felt like I was in a parade. Everybody, Rabbit, good to see you, Rabbit. Hey, see you later, Rabbit. It felt real good. I got home, and of course, you get inspired more. You get more energy, you feel really positive. And I got home and I told my wife, man, it was incredible. It was beautiful to see everybody again. They say that you can count your friends in a hand. I've heard that saying, but I think I need about 500 to 600 hands, because I've gotten so much love, so much friends, so much families. My wife, you know, she's been, like I said, my caretaker, and it's just beautiful. Some of the cards that I've gotten from around the world, that people that I've met sending me cards, text messages, it's been great. And of course, that lifts up your spirit. You want to keep going, and you want to say, I can do this, I can do this. When I see people now, they say, hey, you're walking now? Yes, wow, that's great, man, congratulations. You feel true love, and you feel very honored that these people are saying it with true love from their heart. Not just, hey, what's up, man, how are you? Look good. No, they literally stop to talk to you, and you feel the respect and you feel the love from these people. I'm very blessed to say that. My name is Marcos Arellano. I work for the City of San Diego Fire Department, and I am a lowrider role model.